Check 1, 2.
My hand will save.
hardest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, welcome to morning prayer for this second Sunday after Pentecost. The hour is coming and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for such the Father seeks to worship him. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins to our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us adore him.
Bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us adore him.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the of the Lord in the land of the living.
How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things he has done for me? I will lift up the cup of salvation.
Of the Lord in the land of the living.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving.
Of the Lord in the land of the living.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. World without end. Amen.
A reading from Genesis. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes. Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, where is your wife Sarah? And he said, there in the tent. Then one said, I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself and saying, after I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure? The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son. But Sarah denied, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. He said, oh, yes, you did laugh. The word of the Lord. Reading from Romans. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. And endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord. A reading from Matthew. Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip, and Bartholomew, Thomas, and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon, the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no house of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two, two, or two tunics, or sandals, or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. And children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. The word of the Lord.
At times, I feel quite fortunate that I was raised on a working farm. And I am surprised from time to time how some of the learnings of such an upraising have demonstrate themselves. An appreciation for the land, the need to care for environment and equipment alike. I found that many of the skills and experiences learned in rural Virginia translate into my modern suburban life. However, other talents forged on the farm remain somewhat singularly useless. I've not had a need to call upon my arc welding skills since I was in high school. Related to the gospel today, one of the insights into life that I realized as I walked my grandfather's fields is that the crop is ready when the crop is ready. You cannot hurry it along, but when it ripens, it needs to be addressed. As we reflect on Matthew's gospel, today's text should be read with a sense of urgency. Jesus describes the crowds as in great need. They are sheep without a shepherd. This is a dangerous position in which the crowds find themselves. They are at great risk of being harassed. Cutting to the chase, Jesus depicts them as helpless. Jesus has traveled about the cities and villages. He's been with the people in the synagogues where he taught of the realities of the kingdom of God. Jesus has been with them in the moments of most profound need, in their grief, in their weariness. Curing every disease and every sickness, Jesus has grown close to these crowds, and the crowds have become dear to him. And compassion comes to a head in Jesus. Not some ideal sentiment, but from his very core, a force that prompts him to act. Using imagery, the crowds are fields ripe for harvest. Laborers are needed, and they're needed immediately to bring in the crop. It needs to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed now. These needs of the crowds are immediate. 12 disciples are authorized and empowered to engage and expand the work being done by Jesus. The necessity of haste is underscored by what the 12 did not do. They did not pause for discussions about right doctrines or budgetary restrictions or tidy answers to their questions. The haste also makes for some rather interesting vetting of these disciples. When we get to those lists in Scripture, we are tempted just to skip right over them. But if we move too quickly past this list provided in Matthew's gospel, we notice that Matthew, the tax collector, a minion of Rome, is included right beside Simeon the Cananean, an enemy of Rome. Cananean is an Aramaic transliteration of a word that means zealot. The urgency of the need overcomes old hatreds. The need is paramount. We can easily envision the scenes between the commissioning and the disciples finally stepping across the threshold and walking down the street. Disciple after disciple, hands in the air. But Jesus, what about? Fill in the blank. Jesus, what if? Fill in the blank. Jesus, how do I? Fill in the blank. And each question, each concern, is addressed by Jesus by, do what you've seen and heard me do and say. That's important to grasp. Proclaiming the kingdom of heaven, healing the sick, raising the dead, cleansing the lepers, and casting out demons are the very actions of Jesus. The disciples are being asked to do much more than being obedient to their orders from Jesus. They've been invited into participating in the very life and ministry of Jesus. What we see then is Jesus' charge to the disciples is an avenue for the disciples to better understand Jesus' life. Jesus proclaims the kingdom of God is understood best with dirty hands and sweaty brows. The kingdom of God is not a heady philosophical ideal. It's earthy. It's only in walking the fields that a farmer learns to become a farmer, really become a farmer. It's only being with the crowds and their helplessness and harassed state will the disciples come to truly grasp the meaning of Jesus' proclamation of the kingdom of God. And that's the greatest learning of all. The kingdom of heaven, the reign of God, it changes everything. It changes how we see the world, how we look upon one another, how we understand ourselves, how we experience God. God's reign is awesome, beyond imagination. Chris Glaster writes, "It's a place of healing and a place of trust for those who are sent and for those who welcome them. It's a spiritual commonwealth of which we are, every one of us, fellow citizens and heirs with Christ as beloved children of God." Jesus knew that. He sent his disciples out to their own people to learn, not just teach that truth. The fields are ripe. The harvest is plentiful. Are we going to answer that same call to compassion? The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The prayers. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. The Collect of the Day. Keep, O Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion. For the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A Collect for Grace. Lord God, almighty and everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity. In all we do, direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. During the silence after each of these biddings, please offer prayers of intercession and thanksgiving. Lord, you are the light of the world. Bring the light of your gospel to the ends of the earth. Use us to be instruments of your freedom, justice, and peace. Lord,
Lord, you are the bread of life. Use us to give food to the hungry and nourish us all with your saving word. Lord, you are our way, our truth, and our life. Hear our prayer for the church, for all ministers and all the people of God. Guide us and all who follow you in the way. Deepen our appreciation of your truth and renew us with your life. Lord, you are our blessing and our joy. We thank you for all the blessings of this life, for those who love us, for occupations that fulfill us, and for leisure that restores us. Make us faithful stewards of your bounty. Lord, you are resurrection and life. We remember before you all who have died. Receive them into eternal life and raise us with them into the joy of your heavenly kingdom. Lord, you are our hope and our strength. Be close to all who are alone, rejected, unemployed, and give courage to all who are without hope. Lord, you are the good shepherd who gave your life for the sheep. Hear our prayer for all who are in need, sorrow, or sickness. Bind up the injured, heal the sick, and inspire those whose faith is broken. God of all eternity, hear our prayers and let each new day be for us a time to testify to the all-embracing love of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A Collect for Mission. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross, that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you, for the honor of your name. Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service
and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, blessings this day.